And we're live.
Hi, my name is Victoria Pryor, and I'm the Student Services Program Manager for the Black Student Cultural Center. And I'd like to welcome everyone to our event this afternoon.
Hello.
Thank you, Victoria.
Thank you, Victoria.
I'm Gladys Mitchell-Walthour, and I am an Associate Professor in the Department of African and African Diaspora Studies. We are having this series in October. We will have two speakers. November, we will have another speaker. And December, we will have a speaker. So I just want to introduce the speakers that we're going to have. And of course, Ms. Pryor is going to introduce our speaker today. So for this month, we have two speakers, and we are very fortunate to have Mr. Claiborne Benson, who's going to speak today. October 29th, we will have Dr. Flavia Rios, who is a professor in Brazil at the Federal University Fluminense. And November 19th, we will have Dr. Monique Liston, who is here in Milwaukee. And then December 3rd, we will have Douglas Belchior, who is a Black activist in Brazil. The theme of this webinar is Black history and Black activism in Brazil and the United States. I really wanted to put this together along with Victoria Pryor to give students the opportunity to learn how Black people have been organizing, as well as learn about Black history in a comparative framework, so that students in the United States will know that this is not an isolated issue in terms of recent events and things like that, but it's transnational. So I will turn it over to Victoria.
Thank you. Well, it's my distinct pleasure to introduce Mr. Claiborne Benson. Mr. Benson is a photographer, historian, and military veteran whose professional career with WTMJ TV spans almost 4 years. While working at WTMJ, Benson enrolled in MATC's photography training program, and from there he went to New Jersey to military photography school. Ultimately, Benson earned a Bachelor of Arts degree in film from the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee while working full-time at WTMJ. Towards the end of his studies at UW-Milwaukee, Benson applied for and received a grant that enabled him to produce a documentary called Black Communities, which is a three-part film on Black housing, migration, settlements, and trade skills in the United States, Wisconsin, and Milwaukee. This was the realization became the catalyst for him founding a museum to preserve and maintain the culture of African-American Wisconsinites. And that became the Wisconsin Black Historical Society Museum. The doors opened in 1987, and the overarching mission of the museum is to preserve the history of African Americans in Wisconsin. Benson's professional and personal experiences have enabled him to travel nationally and internationally, from Milwaukee Brewers training camp in Arizona to Russia and China, just to name a few. He is the father of two adult daughters. He's the recipient of numerous awards and citations. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mr. Claiborne Benson.
And I'm honored to be here. Thank you very much. I'm a graduate of UWM and always participating in UWM's activities is one of my favorites. And so here I stand. I'm going to talk about Wisconsin's African-American history with a flavor towards voting, because voting is coming up before us, our presidential voting. And Wisconsin, or Wisconsin's had a voting history of significance. And so I'm going to talk about it. I wanted to say before I get started that slavery did exist in the state of Wisconsin from 1818 through the 1850s, even though the Northwest Ordinance and many state laws prevented slavery from existing, or said that slavery should not exist, it still did exist in the state of Wisconsin. I have to be mindful to say that in the 19th Amendment which is passed in 1920, allowing women the right to vote. State of Wisconsin is the first state to do that, to amend that into our constitution. In the nation of the 50 states, Wisconsin's first to do so. We also should be celebrating the 15th Amendment, because as much as we talk about voting, the 15th Amendment passed in 1870, gave African Americans the right. And it was a challenging and very difficult time to even get that, because women felt offended that African American men would get the right to vote before them. So I don't have to go far to talk about, we're going to the next slide now. I don't have to go far to talk about voter suppression. The voter frustration that people received in April the 7th, 2002, when the governor through COVID-19 issued a stay-at-home order to all of the state citizens, only traveling necessarily, when we had a voting issue come before us, with thousands and thousands of people having to stand in long lines to vote. Only four polling places open. That clearly was a sign of voter suppression, limiting people from voting in cold weather, in long lines. And it did exist in Wisconsin, again, a voting frustration on the part of people. And in the 2000s, the NAACP filed a lawsuit against the state Supreme Court, demanding that African Americans have the right to vote without driver's license. But driver's license was required for people to vote. Nowhere in the Constitution does that say that people have to have a driver's license, but in Wisconsin, in fear of someone cheating on the voting. In the history of Wisconsin, no one's found African Americans anyway, none cheating on in voting. And so that was a major issue. And African Americans had to go to court to be able to vote because of voter license or required to vote. If we step back in time, just like I talk about voting and how voting has been has impacted African Americans, because that's one of the citizenship requirements for folks. We should say that it's a northern state and there was no slavery in the state of Wisconsin. Indeed, there was slavery in the state of Wisconsin, in the western part of the state. We should go to the next slide if we would. That map, yes. In those areas, you could see where there is slavery in the state of Wisconsin, inside small parts of Iowa, small parts of Illinois, but all throughout in Platteville and Belmont and Lancaster and Dodgeville, there is mines and lead mines that exist in those areas. In the 1830s, 1820s, 1830s, and 1840s, they were heaven. Much like the gold rush of California, miners come from all over the country to come to Wisconsin and the western part of the state to harvest lead. And that lead was very important to this country's development. You could see lead is used in bullets and cannonballs, and it's the zinc is used in the gunpowder, and from 1840s through 1860s through 1940s, the lead from that area becomes very important to development of this country. And also slave labor is used to harvest that material. Not a lot of enslaved labor, but certainly enough. You could say a number of 300 to 600 enslaved people at different times harvest that lead in that area. And that's a very significant, important moment in time. Henry Dodge, our first territorial governor, has five slaves, and he frees them and gives them 40 acres, 60 acres, and 20 acres and an ox. He does this in 1827 and 1829 in the state of Wisconsin. So the state is becoming a state in 1846, and we still have to look at that word disenfranchised because it becomes a major issue. As we use it so freely today, it was still a very important word used in the 1846. After the state said that it wanted to be a state, and the founding fathers put the issue of suffrage for African Americans in the first constitutional law. State wanted to be a state in 1846, but those people living in the western part of the state voted no to statehood based on African Americans were citizens in the 1846 version. And so as we move to the next slide, we'll see the state of Wisconsin becomes a state in 1848 with the African Americans' right to vote taken out of the state's constitution, and the state becomes a legal state. And if you look at this picture, for example, you'll see that on one side we see sailors and the other side we see miners, talking about the importance of mining in the state of Wisconsin and the revenue that it brings to the growth of this state. You could also see that the growth of the state starts in the western part of the state, not in the eastern part of the state. Also, they're very, very important. Let's go to the next slide, if you would, please. In 1850, Henry Clay and John Calhoun negotiate, but before I tell you that, in the United States Constitution passed in 1793, the Fugitive Slave Law is one of the laws put in place to ensure continued slavery. And so the Fugitive Slave Law is in there, and it says that runaway slaves must be returned to their proper owner. Henry Clay and John Calhoun are frustrated with the North for not following that order. And so there's one state that stands out, and that's Wisconsin. In the case of Joshua Glover, who comes to the state of Wisconsin by way of the Underground Railroad from St. Louis. And he comes here in 1852. He sets up in Racine, and he's captured in 54. He is taken to Cathedral Square, and he is beaten up, put in jail. Paul Revere, Sherman Booth, we've all heard of Sherman Booth, who goes through the countryside, and we must break out Joshua Glover. We must get Joshua Glover out of jail and take him to Canada, and abolitionists from all over, 500 abolitionists come to Joshua Glover's rescue and they break him out of jail. Now that's an important number because it's those kind of people, the sentiment of people in the state that felt that indeed they want Glover not to be incarcerated and any runaway slave. It's not about Glover, it's about the idea that Wisconsin stands for more than incarcerating African-Americans. And so they ensured that Glover and any other runaway slave by committing this act that they would have free access all the way to Canada. Now, I'm saying this simply because other states felt the same way, but what they did is they did it in the dark. They did it when the military went away. They did it secretly. Wisconsin did it in the open, and Wisconsin thus becomes the first state to openly defy the Fugitive Slave Law and insisted on not allowing enslaved people to be jailed and returned to their proper owner. Wisconsin really stands out in this endeavor. And so Glover goes on to Waukesha, and then from there to Burlington, Wisconsin, and then by ship to Canada, and raises a second family. The issue of voting never goes away, because we were denied the right to vote in 1848 when we became a state. Throughout the 1850s, there's marches, there's demonstrations, there's conventions, there's just protests over the issue that African Americans should have the right to vote. That the state founding fathers saw it in 46, and that should continue. So a man by the name of William Randall, next slide if we would please, William Randall, who is about to become governor, ensure that the issue of suffrage or the right to vote is put on the gubernatorial ballot. And as he is campaigning throughout the state, he is promoting the idea that African Americans should have the right to vote. Part of the state wants all people to vote, and the other part says no. And so it becomes quite a strain for the state. In 1857, when Randall wins, he's a German, by the way, and speaks a broken English. When he wins, so does the issue of suffrage for African Americans. However, people didn't believe that it was accurate, and the issue was sent back to the courts for reconsideration, and thus we weren't able to vote. The Civil War comes and goes, and a man by the name of Ezekiel Gillespie, let's go to the next slide if we would please. Ezekiel Gillespie sues the state of Wisconsin for the right to vote. He insists that he has that right to vote, and he sues the state of Wisconsin. They take a petition, all of the veterans and citizens with property and money throughout the state. And the petition is the event that actually convinces state Supreme Court that indeed African Americans should have the right to vote. And then indeed African Americans gained that right to vote in 1866. African American men, that's important to remember, not women, African American men gained the right to vote in 1866. But keep in mind that in 1870, all African American men throughout the United States, 1870, the 15th Amendment to the Constitution, gained the right to vote in 1870. And we gained that right to vote. Going back to the economic development, Moses and Catherine Stanton founded the city of Chilton. It was called Stantonville at the time in the 1850s. It's up on Highway 57 going north towards Green Bay. Her cemetery is still there, as well as Stanton. They're the part of the Oneida tribe. And if you go across the lake there, you'd see City of Oshkosh, which is named after Chief Oshkosh. And if you look very closely to the face of Chief Oshkosh, he has broad noses, he has brown tone and dark skin, and I'm not saying what he is, I'm simply saying he has some African ancestry in his bloodline, and many of those Native Americans do at that time. So throughout the 1860s, there's turmoil. The 1870s, 1880s, 1890s, the turn of the century. But before the turn of the century, we get a guy by the name of, I'm trying to think of his name. He wants the Civil Rights Act passed in 1895. William T. Green is his name, and William T. Green sues on behalf of Mr. Howard, and then in 1895 he petitions the state legislature that a civil rights law should pass for all citizens, and it does pass, so that indeed African Americans have equal rights, and that law still is on the books today in 1895. Plessy versus Ferguson passes the next year, 1896, saying segregation throughout the country. But Wisconsin does have a civil rights law passed in 1895. So at the turn of the century, African Americans are beginning to come to the state of Wisconsin. Keep in mind that we have small numbers. We're not talking big numbers. We're talking 3,000, 3,500 people. And in 1920s, we get Mr. Palmer, who runs for office and is elected, but Mr. Palmer does not produce a photograph, and he is a man of color. He actually wins. Palmer Street School is named after him. Palmer Street is named after him. He only serves one time, and they kick him out of office for that one time. But the issue of voting never goes away. Mr. Palmer's election is almost like, it's important, but people don't pay attention to it. It's a period that comes later where that really empowers people to begin to think about real growth in Milwaukee. That's in the 1920s. The Columbia Savings Loan comes to Milwaukee. Mr. Edgar Thomas opens up a drugstore in the 1920s. People begin to open their eyes and saying, we want true leadership. And go to the next slide, if you would, please. In 1937, people were saying, and that being Mr. James Dorsey, is saying that I want to run for office and in 1937 to be an alderman. And the alderman at the time, Mr. Samuel Swoof, gets, if we take a step back in the slides, he gets two teachers, Miss Ellis, who I got to know, and Mrs. French, were the first African-American teachers to be assigned to become teachers. That was such a milestone for our communities that people were so impressed with Samuel, a white alderman, that they supported him and voted for him. And Mr. Dorsey, who was the other candidate for office, a black man, did not win that office. And he was a very qualified candidate. Let's go to the next slide, please. And this is a picture of Mr. James Dorsey, who ran for office unsuccessfully against Samuel Smith. So that was a very significant. And go to the next slide, if you would. These are the people who supported him, because they all realized how important he was, and he was very important. He was the director of the NAACP, but these weren't the only black lawyers in Milwaukee. We had some terrific black lawyers in Milwaukee. And another one is Cox. And let's go to the next slide, if you would. Mr. Cox ran for county supervisor in the 1960s, 1950s, and is elected. And he becomes very important in our community. Let's go to the next slide. In the 1940s, another opportunity comes for the candidates to become candidates. And so a whole pool of them begin to run for office. Dr. Bobo is very important. Mr. Lathan, Mr. Taylor, all of these people are significant citizens that make a big contribution to Milwaukee. And they decide among themselves that indeed, we're gonna pick the best candidate of us, and we're gonna support that candidate. But they too are defeated. They too are ushered out and does not have a chance to win. The next slide, if we would, please. This is Dr. Edgar Thomas, and I mentioned him a little bit earlier. Dr. Edgar Thomas is from the third from the right with his hat down, sort of looking a little disheveled, but that's only because he is doing all of the work. Dr. Edgar Thomas is a socialist, and he opens up a drugstore. He opens a drugstore. Now, we're all familiar with, what's the name of the doctor over on Burleigh? I forgot his name. Anyway, but we know about that doctor. Dr. Edgar Thomas is a very important doctor in Milwaukee and a very economic development minded. He purchased a great deal of land in Racine and created and promoted the idea of Black people migrating to this area and buying land and building their homes. And he's not successful in doing that, but he's a very important doctor. He does a lot with his education. He ends up dying in 1968. But Dr. Edgar Thomas is very, very important to this community. Let's go to the next slide, if you would. Next slide. So again, in the economic development piece, going back to Columbia Savings and Loan starts in 1924, and Columbia Savings and Loan finds that Black people are not given loans for homes that they want to build or to want to purchase, and so that they sell bonds and build up enough revenue so that they can lend money to homeowners. And so they are very, very important. And it comes in the form of Mrs. Audie Halyard and her husband, Wilbur. Go to the next slide, if you would. And this is a picture of Mrs. Halyard. A street is being named in her honor. Now, Mrs. Halyard is important because she becomes the director of the statewide NAACP, and she begins to organize other NAACP offices throughout the state of Wisconsin, in Kenosha, in Racine, in Madison. Mrs. Halyard, and eventually through her office, encourages other people to run for president of the Milwaukee branch. James Dorsey was the president prior to Mrs. Halyard taking over. And they had different styles. James Dorsey did all the work himself. He is a lawyer, took the cases to court and addressed the issues almost by himself. Mrs. Halyard functioned within the guidelines of the national NAACP and created these committees. So the NAACP was driven by members through committees and forms and structures, and which was a totally different, and Mrs. Halyard eventually won out. Another really important thing that she did, some of you may have heard of the Amoson Andy shows of the early 1950s, 40s and 50s. Mrs. Halyard didn't like the Amoson Andy shows. She thought that they demeaned African-Americans and we were better than Amoson Andy. And she encouraged television stations all over the country to discontinue them. And so that really was the demise of the Amoson Andy shows because it began to decline. And eventually the networks did not pick that up anymore. She really was the catalyst for civil riots and demonstrations. She is the one who formalized and started the youth council members of the NAACP. Of course, this is 1950s and it was for another purpose, but the same body of people goes on to be those demonstrators throughout the 1960s. Mrs. Audie Halyard. Could you go to the next slide, please? Families begin to still come to the Milwaukee because of seeing opportunities. Schools are opening up, and yes, there are jobs, but the most important thing is those young people being able to get an education, being able to go to schools. 4th Street School, 9th Street School, all begin to open up. Next slide, if you would, please. People had jobs or got jobs. This is a woman who is just dropping her daughter off. So you can see her in the background, and she has a uniform on for domestic work, and that is what she did. She was a domestic worker. And she often they would pick them up at different locations. I remember when I was a kid, they would pick up domestic workers on what street was that? Capitol Drive in Oakland, right on the corner to Capitol Drive in Oakland, and they went north. That is what that. Next slide, please, if you would, please. So domestic work in Wisconsin, Milwaukee is the largest tanneries anywhere in the world. There are more tannery operations anywhere. And now I have pictures of people with gas masks and are coated with protective coats to protect themselves. And this young man is operating out of with virtually no clothes at all and don't really care. He feels that it's not gonna harm him. But those chemicals are used to take off the membrane from the inner side of the skin to make hides and purses and shoes and leather products. And they impacted the human skin. And so it was very dangerous work for them. Hard and dangerous work, heavy and dangerous, and it stunk. And the Black workers worked in that hot area. You may not be able to see this very well, but that hole that he's working out of is a tank. And sometimes it's 20 feet wide. There's so much leather products going in. The chemicals are toxic. We can go to the next slide, please. My family were barbers, and this is a barbershop. I bet you there are barbershops and beauty shops. We had a beauty shop. Ella's was next door to our barbershop, but there are barbershops and beauty shops all over the city. This is the kind of work in which folks were able to do, and they supported their families, educated their families, all in barbershop dollars that they were able to provide it and make sure that they got an education based on that. Could we turn next slide, please, if we would? Next slide, if we could. So now, I mentioned in the 1940s how we were denied the right to vote, but that didn't turn us around, because between 1937, when attorney James Dorsey did not win till 1957, there's an onslaught, there's a continued effort on our part to get from county supervisor to alderman. We constantly tried to. And this is Mary Allen Shadd. Mary Allen Shadd is a publisher of a book. She's a salesperson. Her son is the owner of the WNOV radio station, Gerald Jones. And Mary Allen Shadd ran for alder person two. She was the first woman to run for office. This is in 1956. In 1957, Vail wins. Could you turn to the next page, please? And we're gonna come to a picture of Vail in a minute, and I will resume that conversation. But Martin Luther King comes to Milwaukee in 1964. He comes in 57 first, and he speaks down at the Lutheran Church on Wisconsin Avenue. I believe it's 21st, 22nd Street. But he speaks there, a very liberal church. And he comes to Wisconsin 12 times to speak. His favorite city was Racine. His family, and he had friends in Racine, and they would come to Racine on a regular basis to visit folks. But Racine is a very significant, important city to him. And the times that he does come, he is flooded with threats. He's called a communist, and even when he speaks at the auditorium, there's a bomb threat throughout the entire auditorium, although he continued with his presentation. There is constantly pressure from the conservative side that he was not the person they wanted in Wisconsin. We go to the next slide, please. This is a picture of, I don't know the lady in the center, but the Mrs. OB, and Val Phillips is at a reception. Val has won the election in 57, and she becomes well known for winning the election. It was a moment of relief for citizens throughout the city. We finally got a representation. She becomes the darling of the Democratic Party. She is assigned national committees determining Democratic policies. She is sent throughout the entire world giving lectures about human relations and human issues. She becomes very important, wins national and international awards. She becomes very, very important, not just in Milwaukee, but all over the country. And then obviously later goes on to be a judge and Secretary of State. Go to the next slide, if you would, please. This is the graininess, but this is another effort on the part of our citizens, not only to win office, but to develop an economic arm. This is Mr. Mack comes up with the idea that he wants to open up a brewery. Slitz owns Blatt's Beer. Blatt's is up for sale along the Walnut Street and farther south. There is a whole line of Blatt's breweries, and he wants to buy Blatt's, but the system refuses to sell a major brewery to an African American. And so Theodore applies for federal grants and buys a building in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, and is successful and opens up a brewery in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, and lives his time there in Oshkosh. Theodore is important, and Theodore, although is somewhat conservative, he is a big supporter of attorney Lloyd Bobby. He is like the second lieutenant who fights for the desegregation of school systems. Theodore is the president of the 1963 March on Washington, D.C., and he takes at least five or six buses to Washington, D.C., and organizes that folks that go to Washington and takes care of folks. Theodore is a real leader in Milwaukee community. Let's go to the next slide, if we would, please. And so again, we're not just talking about a brewery, we're talking about economic development across the board. And along with having the right to vote, we need the right to have an economic development, to take care of ourselves. We don't want to just be working in tanneries and doing construction sites and working in barbershops. We want to own our businesses. And these initiatives starting in the 1960s, it didn't start in the 1960s, but continued and grew. Now this is 1970 when Theodore opens up the People's Beer, but there's grocery stores, there are laundromats, and if we go to the next slide, you can see this is the Walnut Street Business District Committee, and there is said to be 52-53 businesses opened up along that Walnut Street corridor, and so that was a very important business organization, and people work together to create an economic arm. We go to the next slide, please. This is Walnut Street when it's torn down. 1962, 1963, Walnut Street. It has condemned all of the buildings, and these buildings about ready to be torn down. This is the winter of and those buildings probably would be torn down in the spring of the coming year. The next slide, if you would, please. There is a cry for African-American identity and strength. And it starts with the having our proper representation in 1937 through 1957 when Val's elected, but it doesn't go away. This is the march on Washington, D.C. And yes, this is 1995, but it's a growing internal drive on the part of Black men and women to be independent and be strong and not be stepped on and being just domestic work. And if we go to the next slide, you can see that when they step out of the realm, they say, yes, we want economic development. And yes, we want the ability to provide for ourselves. But the key and most important thing that we really, really want is education. Now, yes, Brown versus the Board of Education is passed in 1954, but what we found out in Milwaukee and Chicago and Boston and Indianapolis, we found out that Black kids are being bused, white kids are being bused to their schools, and they come at 8 o'clock and they put into their classes. And the Black kids are being bused from Black schools. The Black schools are torn down in their neighborhoods. They're bused to white schools. People and parents accept that because we're going to white schools, better books and better classrooms, better environments. They're sent to the back of the schools in trailers and back of the schools, and they're continued to be segregated even in those white schools. And that was not tolerated with. And so, Lloyd Bobby filed two federal lawsuits against the Milwaukee public school systems. Now, I'm going to say to you that just like I mentioned, all of those other cities were participating in the segregation systems and policy. It's Lloyd Bobby in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, that filed these federal lawsuits. It's Lloyd Bobby who pushed that. He won in the federal courts. He won in both Amos versus the Milwaukee public school system and versus the Milwaukee public schools. In both cases, Lloyd Bobby won and caused an end to the segregation of school systems, even in white neighborhoods. Another real important issue that Milwaukee faced, and go to the next slides, is the fair housing legislation. Now, I'm going to say to you, and I'm not mentioning all the women. I could mention Miss Bernice Lindsay, and obviously Audie Hallier. All of those women fought on housing issues. Their whole emphasis was about housing and housing and housing. That's the way, if you looked at Walnut Street, that housing was in such poor, poor condition. African-Americans lived in third and fourth and even fifth generational housing, and it was in horrible shape. And African-Americans were forced to live. In some cases, they didn't have any place to live. And it's Father James Groppi who picks up the banner to fight for fair housing. To say that that's totally correct and it's fixed now, I could not say that. Or even if our kids are getting an equal education in school systems, is not so. But they fought the fight. In 1967, Father James Groppi made a decision to organize the youth council members, and for 200 days and nights and lunchtimes, they traveled to various locations. They traveled to aldermen's houses. They travel to offices. They travel to communities like Wauwatosa, Southside. They travel all over the state and the community, all with the idea that they are going to fight against desegregation of schools, fair housing legislation that existed in the state of Wisconsin. And finally, in September of 1967, Grappi and two commandos is invited to Washington, D.C. By President Lyndon Johnson, who has on his desk a bill that Minnesota Mundell issued in the spring of the year, but it wasn't going anywhere. So as Father James Grappi that goes and testifies before Congress, convinces the committee that indeed this is a bill worthy of passing. And as a result of King's passing in April of 1968 and Grappi's visit, the Fair Housing Bill actually passes and passes it. And we have a not just a state, but a federal fair housing bill. And I want to go on to my, although it's not the last struggle that we go on, I wanted to talk about welfare reform. Now, I grew up as a kid on welfare. It was a very difficult time. But welfare reform originates out of Wisconsin, out of Milwaukee. And it's these women who goes on to end welfare as we know it today. And that originates in Wisconsin under the Tommy Thompson's administration. And change. That concludes my comments as it relates. Thank you.
Mr. Benson, thank you so much for that excellent presentation.
Thank you.
I think every time I hear you speak, I learn something new. So this was really, really great. I hope my students that you all took notes because I have like a page of notes. So what I want to do now is allow for people to put questions into the Q&A, and then we can read those. But we do actually have some questions that a graduate student who's a TA for the class that she sent in, and then I was also taking some notes. So what I'm going to do is just read maybe two or three questions, and then from those you can choose what you want to answer. And then we'll just kind of keep an eye to see if other questions come in. So one of the questions that was emailed, okay, I'll read two of these questions that were emailed. One is, what rules or values has Mr. Benson adopted for addressing racism in his professional career? The other was, what continues to frustrate Mr. Benson now as a resident of Milwaukee? And then for the third question, I will ask one that I wrote down, which is, in your presentation, so of course Milwaukee has both, or Wisconsin, has both a conservative history, but it also has a progressive history. So I just wanted you to talk a little bit about, so how did Wisconsin go from being this place where people like Joshua Glover was able to be, you know, rescued and then was able to, you know, leave, sure, as well as.
Let me start with that. Because that's a very important question. And thank you for listening.
Well, the other part was, how did it go from that to being the worst state in the United States?
I can't say from that moment to 2020, but I can say, if you ask the question, what was in the hearts and the minds of Europeans who gathered at Glover's breaking out of jail. I used to think it was 5,000, but it's 500 people that actually didn't, but that's still a sizable number of abolitionists who broke him. And they were serious. And if you look, what is the name of the newspaper in the city of Waukesha? I'm just asking a rhetorical question. And it is Freedmen. that is the mood and the spirit of the philosophy of those citizens in the city of Waukesha. They did not like slavery, and they weren't going to tolerate with it. Now, did that mean that they liked African Americans? I'll tell you no. Did they see us as laborers in a sense? Yeah, that we perform now. They paid us minimum wage or work, but they didn't like their, some of them were free soilists. Some of them were Republicans, and a different kind of Republican than today, but Republicans that believed in free labor. And so their political philosophies didn't permit them to stay on board with enslavement and philosophy. Many of their ancestors themselves were enslaved. And so they took that same philosophy when they came to this country. They came to this country to be Underground Railroad people. They didn't just come over here and decide that Black people were being mistreated and that they were going to do something about it. When they left the shores of Europe, they left with the philosophy of fighting against enslavement, and so that they did. And the political philosophies that they maintained embodied in them non-slavery philosophies. And so that is their motivation. Again, did they necessarily want to embrace or to make Black people part of their family or marry them or let them live next door? No, but they were willing to give their lives to make sure the slavery. Take a good example of Caroline Quarles walking through the streets in Burlington, raising $11 with her conductor, a white man. And their family even today brags about the accomplishment of their ancestors for raising money, $11. But that was enough to get Caroline Quarles to Canada. And countless a number of Europeans made grave sacrifices to prevent slavery from existing in the state of Wisconsin, in a way in which we know. I'm not saying that there weren't some slavery going on. I'm not going to tell you that. I'm going to say to you overall, there was less than other states. Now, your picture has been frozen.
Great. So there's another question that came in into the question and answer, so I'm going to read that one. The history of the advancement of Blacks in Milwaukee is quite nonviolent. This is what the person is assuming. What explains this moment of peaceful without war movement towards development within the Black community in Wisconsin? How does this relate to the status of Black Milwaukee today? How can one understand this peaceful moment in the context of white supremacy in the United States of America?
I'm not sure I understand that question, but I, let me take a piece of that question if I could, please. I don't think it's non-violent. I think that there are some moments which is really violent. You could take that in case of Marshall Clark. Marshall Clark is lynched in Milwaukee. But that's a long story. The Europeans are very violent. And so we can start with Glover's being broken out of jail and taken to Canada. And we can start with the governor taking the position, William Randall, that we're going to fight against. He's a German. He's an abolitionist. And he's going to say, we're going to fight against slavery in our state, and we're going to do Underground Railroad activities and such, and on and on. Well, Henry Clay and John Calhoun made an agreement in the Great Compromise of 1850 that we would not allow expansion to the West if you would stop enslaving, conducting Underground Railroads to the North. And you are not obeying that agreement. That's what's being said to Wisconsin. And the governor then says to all of its national guards, I'm giving you a narrative, a very violent narrative that is coming up. The governor says to all of the national guards throughout the state of Wisconsin, get ready, get your guns ready, be prepared, because we are going to be facing with a threat from the federal government of not obeying the fugitive slave law, not obeying the Great Compromise agreed to in Washington, D.C. We are alone, stay by ourselves, and we may be faced with government troops from Washington, D.C. And one of their National Guard units, the one in the Irish community in the Third Ward, said to the government, we obey not the state government, but the federal government. And if the federal government wants us to march on Madison or stop a certain action in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, that is what we're going to do. Of course, this is the time when it was unclear on whether or not the National Guard was to support state causes or federal causes. This particular National Guard unit thought it ought to face federal government, federal issues. And the National Guard gives an order to Rufus King. He is Colonel Rufus King at the time. We've all heard of Rufus King High School. It's named in his honor. He goes to the National Guard and the Irish community, takes away their weapons and decommission them. They are upset about this. And so that they get on a boat. Lady Elgin is the name. And they get on the boat and they go down to Chicago to a Democratic convention. Raise the money to purchase new weapons. And they're on their way back to Milwaukee after a couple of days of fun picnicking and raising money. And their ship sinks. Out of 300 people, out of 400 people, 300 of them die in Lake Michigan. That was a drastic moment for the Irish community. I read that there was not a dry eye in the whole Irish community in Third Ward. It was devastating. The community is so upset. And as a result of that, 2 years later, after a scrimmage or fight in the streets with Marshall Clark and Sheldon, his friend, two Irishmen dies, and Marshall Clark is lynched. And Marshall Clark is lynched in downtown Milwaukee, and the African-American community becomes desperate, and they leave the state. They leave, and I'm not saying the whole community, but many of the citizens find that Milwaukee is not acceptable, and there's no law and order, and they're going to leave, and they leave. So there is a layer of violence in this community, and that in it's suppressed. It's a silent kind of a mean-spirited kind of suppress. If you don't think hiring two Black teachers and convincing the Black community and the Black newspaper to not vote for a qualified Black candidate for office is not a mean-spirited and violent act, I don't know what it is. It is a violent act. And the system functions that very way. And they do it even up to today. When I talked about the law saying you have to have a driver's license to vote, nowhere in the Constitution, you have to go to the Supreme Court and argue the question about whether or not, and we still have to have a driver's license to vote. These are all voter suppression methods used on the part of the system to keep African Americans in one area and suppress and not educate them. And their primary goals and objective is to use our labor through unmeaningful tasks. I'm sorry, I'm talking too much, but that is the truth.
Thank you. Actually, with those, I'm just going to go ahead and close with those last words.
Yes.
With the last words that you said. So you explained Milwaukee as being a place this very mean-spirited in terms, but also achieving this, you know, goal of those in power to suppress Black people. And a lot of times in Brazil, when people talk about exactly what you're talking about, it's called racismo cordial, or cordial racism. Yes. It's exactly the same. And when I moved to Wisconsin, it felt so familiar to me. Yeah. And I was like, oh my gosh, this reminds me of Brazil.
Yeah.
I mean, that's exactly, Wisconsin has been the state that most reminds me of the way racism functions in Brazil.
Yeah.
So thank you again. This was an excellent talk. I hope that everyone enjoyed it. And that if you do have any questions, that you email Mr. Benson. And then once this pandemic is over, I encourage everyone to go to the Wisconsin Black Historical Society. It is excellent. Our homeschool group, we have visited. And then of course, for the Kwanzaa celebration, we've consistently went for the past 3 or 4 years. So I encourage everyone to do that, you know, post-pandemic.
yes.
And, you know, we are so fortunate to have access to Mr. Benson. So again, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I look forward to seeing everyone on October 29th.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I'm signing off.
Okay.